So we are, we're roughly halfway through chapter 5, which is about chaos in two-dimensional maps. Last class, we talked about how to, I guess, geometrically think about calculating Lyapunov exponents in dimensions more than one. Concept being, you, in the real world, take a measurement, you have measurement uncertainty associated with it, and when we put that on a computer, that's like, okay, we got a dot. That's our initial value, initial condition. Then we have a ball around it within which we know the true state of the system to be, and we'd like to know what happens to that collection as you iterate forward using the map. So in a nonlinear two-dimensional map, something like the Anon map, a small ball around a point will be deformed into, you know, some sort of wiggly shape. The more nonlinear it is, the more wiggly the shape. And the smaller the ball, as you zoom in, the more it'll look like an ellipse, that wiggly shape. So we are going to try and calculate what happens to a small ball turning into an ellipse. You know, we remember the idea from last time is we get an approximate version of that ellipse, and then we rescale the axis lengths. We take the longer axis, if there is one, and shrink it, and the shorter axis and puff it out, but can we preserve the directions in which those semi-major and minor axes live? And then we have a new little ball around the second point of the orbit. We watch that thing deform. We land around the third point of the orbit with an ellipse, and we do the same procedure. We're going to do this over and over again. Ultimately, you're doing this on your homework. It will be simpler than what we did in class last week. It should be just a few lines of linear algebra. Where we take a matrix that represents that ball. So the two columns of a matrix, for example, in R2 would be 1, 0 and 0, 1 if you wanted to start with I hat and J hat as your W's. And then you multiply that matrix by the Jacobian of the function, matrix of partial derivatives, around the point on the orbit, V0. And that gives you a third matrix, another 2 by 2 matrix that's the Z, that has as its columns the vector Z we talked about last time. And then you do the QR decomposition of that matrix Z. And MATLAB does that for you by you just type little q, little r of Z. And it'll spit back to you two matrices, Q and R. That's what the QR decomposition does. And the matrix Q has as its columns the new W. And the matrix R has on its diagonal the stretching and shrinking required to turn that Z ellipse back into the W. I'm skipping over the Y's because they sort of are given. That all happens inside the QR decomposition. But okay, so in practice, in MATLAB, what I just described is going to be more concise than the whole. We spent a whole class trying to draw what is going on here. But we repeat this procedure over and over again. And on average, that stretching and shrinking represented by the magnitude of the Y's, which live on the diagonal of R, those are going to be our estimates of the Lyapunov exponent. We have more than one of them because we're in more than one dimension. So in one dimension, we were just looking at the average of the slopes. But here, the lengths of these axes, and the axes themselves are turning. That's the stretching or shrinking we care about. Any questions about that? All right, so I have office hours today for an hour and a half right after class here. If we get kicked out there. And then tomorrow also, I think it's 9:30 to 11 over in Farrell, if you want to come by and talk about any of this. And if that doesn't work for you, you could email me your code and say, I'm struggling, what's going on? Try and avoid loops in your code. I don't think you should need them aside from the iterate, how many iterates you're doing. That's something you have to loop over. But this matrix equation thing should work out okay. Questions? Okay, we're going to use these Lyapunov exponents that we get from each dimension. I guess we've only seen one example of this so far. So the skinny Baker map was stretching vertically by a factor of 2, shrinking horizontally by a factor of 3. And so our Lyapunov exponents ended up being natural log of 2, that was in the stretching direction, and negative natural log of 3, which was in the shrinking direction. And those two numbers, they were constant because any point on our orbit kind of experiences the same thing. It's a linear map. Nonlinear maps are not going to have such simple stretching and shrinking because the directions are going to change. For the Skinny Baker map, the directions were always I hat and J hat in which things were happening. True of linear maps, since the Jacobian is independent of the state, those directions don't change. All right, so today we're going to talk about our final definition of the dimension of a set, and it is based on these Lyapunov exponents. And this is sort of the one that you would imagine using for applications like the weather prediction application I mentioned last time, where you have some idea of the local stretching and shrinking of things. And okay, so this is the Lyapunov dimension. And we'll do an example where we try and figure out what the box counting dimension should look like for one of these stretching and shrinking sets, and then see how the Lyapunov exponent definition gives us the same thing. And this should be, we should think about this as easier to calculate than our box counting dimension. Once we get into higher dimensions, this will be easier to do numerically. And it'll come for free with the Lyapunov spectrum. So one of the things I would often do when looking and analyzing one of these chaotic orbits is identifying, quantifying what its Lyapunov exponents are. I'm doing that anyway, and then I can just do a trivial little calculation on those that gives me back this dimension, and we'll see what that is here. All right, so let's just write down what the definition of this dimension is. We'll let F be a map in RM. We're thinking in our head of 2 because it's simply easier to draw, but it can be bigger. And we'll consider an orbit with Lyapunov exponents given by H1 greater than or equal to H2 dot 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 greater than or equal to HM. Some of these could be bigger than 1, some of these could be or bigger than 0, some could be smaller than 0. We only had 2 for the Skinny Baker. We had ln of 2. And then we had minus ln of 3. Okay, and we're going to let P be the largest integer such that if I take the sum from I equals 1 to P of my H's, that sum is positive. We'll talk about why that makes sense after we write down what the definition is for the dimension. We'll say the Lyapunov dimension d sub l of the orbit we use to calculate this spectrum of H's is, it's going to be defined to be 0 if P doesn't exist, what would it mean if P doesn't exist? Looking back at this definition, I'm adding up, like I start with this one, and then I add this to this one, and then I add the H3, and I'm doing that over and over again. I'm just seeing whether I'm positive or not. And if I, all of a sudden I add, you know, H, P plus 1, and the sum becomes negative, I got to back it up 1. That's my P value. Scott?
Would that mean that it's shrinking in all directions?
Shrinking in all directions, yes. So if If P doesn't exist, that means that H1 is negative. Because, so if this were satisfied, if P were 1, that would mean H1 was positive. But if P doesn't exist, then H1 is going to be negative. If the dominant stretching direction or least contracting direction that is, you know, that I'm experiencing is one where stuff is shrinking, then P doesn't exist. And to give you just an example of that, if we take a map, a two-dimensional linear map with eigenvalues that are smaller than 1 in magnitude, maybe they're, you know, complex or something. This, you get a spiral, you know, orbit spirals in. You're looking at the Tinkerbell map, has some examples like that. So spiraling in, the orbit is spiraling in towards a fixed point sink. Okay, what would happen to a little ball if I put the ball around that sink? Well, it's, you know, it's not going to turn into, it could, if their eigenvalues are complex, it should just turn a little, that circle should turn and get smaller. If they're not, if one of the eigenvalues is a half and the other is a quarter, it's going to be an ellipse, but it's shrinking in both directions. So ultimately, R2, fixed point sink, everything's going towards it. What is the dimension of the resulting attractor? Well, if everything's going towards a single point, getting closer and closer to that point, does that point take up any space in R2? It doesn't. There could be some, you know, if the orbit did something else, maybe we could have a dimension. We could have some stuff. I should be careful. The amount of space taken up by it isn't exactly the dimension. Remember, if the dimension's a little, we have a theorem that we looked at maybe a week ago now about the relationship between the measure and the dimension. But in the example case that I'm talking about, and for a parameter value you're looking at in your homework, we end up with, you know, with this being the case that P doesn't exist, and I get a zero-dimensional Lyapunov, you know, attractor or orbit. Okay. Haven't even said much yet. Okay, how about M? We'll say that the dimension is M if P equals M. Okay, so R2, again, let's imagine example R2. And I put a little ball around some fixed point. I just try to decide what happens to that fixed point. Doesn't need to be a fixed point, but put a ball around a fixed point, see what happens. Well, if P is M, what does that mean? It means that I have M of these in R2. There's just two of them. I add them both together, and it's bigger than zero. So the second one could be negative. I could have a positive H1 and a negative H2, but the magnitude of the H2 is smaller than the magnitude of the H1. Stretching is overpowering the shrinking. So if I start with a ball and that's happening, it may turn into an ellipse, but the area of the ellipse is bigger. Determine the Jacobian bigger than 1 and is bigger each time. And so my volume is I'm being, you know, thinking about volume, it's growing. And the resulting attractor that I end up with is actually going to take up all of R2. Its dimension will be 2. So it has some stuff. It has some taking up space going on. And interestingly, it's okay if, you know, H2 is negative there. That's still true. Now, the example that I started talking about a second ago, the Skinny-Baker map example, that's not the case, right? Negative LN3, which is H2 for the Skinny-Baker map, that's bigger than ln of 2, the positive first Lyapunov exponent of the Skinny-Baker map. So for that example's not on here yet. We haven't talked about what that'll be so far. Questions about our two examples? We have one more thing to write down. One more bullet. Questions about these so far? Yeah.
Why does the Skinny-Baker map not fall into either of those?
Good, because so the Skinny-Baker map, we have H1 is ln of 2. That's from the stretching by a factor of 2 vertically each time. And H2 is the ln of 1/3, which is the shrink by a factor of 3 each time. And that's minus ln of 3. And if I think about adding these two up, H1 is positive, so I'm thinking about what my p-value would be. When I add negative ln of 3 to ln of 2, I get a negative number. So I got to back it up 1 and say, oh, well, p would be 1. So for this example, p would be 1. Well, m is 2 here.
Oh, m has to be greater than or
equal to 2. M is 2, and like our map, our Skinny Baker map is in R2. Yeah. That's okay, yeah. Cool, so last thing, well, and this will address the Skinny Baker map, is our dimension, if these, neither of these two things are true, is going to be p plus 1 over the absolute value of h sub p plus 1, the next exponent, the one that tips me over, times the sum, I equals 1 to p, of the hi. This is h sub p plus 1. So it's the magnitude. This thing is necessarily going to be negative, the thing in the denominator, because it is the h that when added to the sum makes the sum negative. Of all, I'm added up all the h's, 1, 2, 3, 4, and I get to this one and I add it up to the sum and it makes it negative. So this will be negative. I'm taking its absolute value. And I'm waiting, so the numerator of this fraction, you could think about putting this in the numerator, is that sum. The sum of all the h's that remains positive. There's a few things happening. One is I get p out front. In this example, that the Skinny Baker example, that's 1. So I would get that thing there to begin with. And that's because I have that stretching by a factor of 2 each time. So I'm going to get at least a one-dimensional object. When we think about what Skinny Baker looks like on your homework, we get the Cantor set in this direction. We get the vertical curves, dimension 1 in that one. Okay, and then what am I left with? I should be left with, in this case, I'll have whatever that sum is. So this is ln of 2, because it's just sum from 1 to 1 of the h's. So that's ln of 2, divided by the absolute value of the next thing, the thing that tips it over. So that would be ln of 3. So for Skinny Baker, this is 1 plus ln of 2 divided by ln of 3, which is the dimension of k infinity. And for more sophisticated examples than that aren't linear, we're going to end up with, you know, some base dimension that we're sitting on plus some fraction. Why does this have to be a fraction? Why is it smaller than 1, this thing? Because it's not. It's smaller than 1. I mean, no, just in general. Why is the additional dust contribution to the dimension? Why is that smaller than 1?
Yes. Yes. Definitely. Yes.
Well, so h sub p plus 1 is big enough in magnitude to make all the previous h's negative. So if it's in the denominator, then it'll be bigger than the sum of the numerator, you know.
Very good. So all of these h's, when I add them up, the sum is potentially getting smaller if some of them are negative, right? And eventually, I add this next one, and it becomes negative, for sure. Which means that without this in the sum, it's a positive, this term is positive. And then I add this, you know, forgetting about the absolute value, I add that negative number to the sum, and it becomes negative. Which means in size, this has to be bigger than this. Which makes this term here a fraction. A fraction smaller than 1, to be more specific. So I have this integer dimension, and the Skinny Baker, that's these vertical lines, plus some stuff that is, you know, the dusty contribution of other things. And to be less specific. So for our example, Skinny Baker, this would be p is 1. So this is going to be 1 plus ln of 2 over ln of 3. which makes sense. And that's what we would have gotten with our box counting dimension. In fact, it's what you would have gotten on your homework, which I think solutions should be coming in a little bit. They weren't over there earlier. Questions about this? Okay, so this is, remember, this is the K infinity contribution. We do the skinny Baker map, specifically because it lets us talk about this for a set that kind of makes sense to us. All right, so let's see if we can understand this here in terms of box counting. My goal is to try and get this business from the box counting dimension that we know how to do. Ln of n over ln of 1 over epsilon, that business. Let's see if we can turn that into this. Okay, let's look at a general a general 2D case, not the skinny Baker map and not linear necessarily, where we don't have dots 1 or 2. We're in the situation where the first Lyapunov exponent is positive and the second one is negative, but bigger in magnitude. So it'll be similar to this in what ends up happening, but it'll be this third dot. All right, so a general 2D case with H1 bigger than 0, bigger than H2, positive Lyapunov exponent in one direction, negative in another. And let's have that H1 plus H2 gives me back a negative number. So I get into this third dot category. The shrinking is stronger than the stretching. If it were the other way around, this would be a 2D attractor that results. Okay, so here's my amoeba-shaped object that I'm going to put a box around. This is going to be a D by D box. And we're going to stretch that thing by F is our function. And let's say we send it through our map K times. So this shape here, it could be a ball to start with, but let's say it's a weird shape. And then I'm going to, when I do that procedure, I end up with some long, stretchy object. So this thing goes to this shape here. And then I have a bunch of boxes that are of different sizes than the one I started with. So the way that this works is I'll end up with two dimensions that depend on my exponents. So this dimension is going to be d in length. It's going to be dE to the k h1, roughly. And this dimension here will be dE to the k h2, where k is how many iterates I've done. And the definition of my exponent, Lyapunov exponent, says that the amount of stretching or shrinking that happens in this direction, the exponent of that process is H1 or H2. So the stretching one we're calling H1, the shrinking one we're calling H2. And so it looks like I started out with an object that fit in one box of length D, and I guess it's the smaller width here. I have five boxes in the picture of side length D e to the k H2. Okay, so the area of the set after k iterates it started out the area was d squared, and now it's d is just a constant for hanging out for how big my area was to begin with. Now it's going to be d squared e to the kh2 times e to the kh1, the area. Bless you. I got k iterates, h1 plus h2. Does this go to infinity or to zero as k goes to the number of iterates goes to infinity? What happens to the area of my set? Why does it go to zero? Good, negative exponent. So the k is getting bigger. D is just a number out front. But this sum, which I have on the board up here, is supposed to be negative. I decided it was negative. If that sum were positive, then p would be 2. P would be m. And my area would, you know, encompass everything. And that would be boring. So this goes to 0. The area goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. We're in R2. We got an area of 0. But the dimension has to be at least 1 because of the stretching direction. Dimension is at least 1. Because stretching. Positive H1. So we're going to try and do the box counting dimension on this thing. All right, so this is my area. Okay. So the area of the set, I'm going to bring it over here. D squared. E to the k copies of h1 plus h2, which I got this just by multiplying together these two dimensions. That's my area. I'm going to rewrite it as the area as d times e to the k h2 quantity squared times the fraction d e to the k h1 divided by d e to the k h2. Which seems kind of weird at first, but but we're trying to manipulate this. We're going to be trying to manipulate this into our box counting formula. And this looks to me like it's going to be the area of the small of the little boxes that we have there. So if the area formula is this, and I have here the area of one box, what does that make this thing here? It makes it the number of boxes. It does not look like the number of boxes. But that's what it has to be. So this is the area of a single box, and this is the number of boxes. I mean, the d's will cancel. I can write that as e to the k h1 minus h2. Like, things are going to happen, but for now, we'll leave it like that. And you know, this is—I've just rewritten this where since I put this in the denominator here, that cancels one of these. But okay, we're peeling this apart now. All right, so let me just write this in words. To cover the image of, you know, the fkth iterate of the original set. Covered the image of the set under FK, we need, we'll write it the nicer way, e to the k h1 minus h2 boxes of side length dE to the k h2. So that's our epsilon. Is it okay that I have an h1 minus h2 in this number that I'm supposed to be getting at? Is that negative or positive, the exponent? It's positive. What is h1 minus h2? H2 is a negative number, right? It has to be in order to be when it adds to h1, making the sum negative. Bless you. So if I do this, I'm really, this is definitely a positive. So my boxes, the number of boxes, this is n. This is going to infinity while this goes to 0. The reciprocal of this will go to infinity, and we're going to measure the ratio of those rates at which those things happen. All right, so the BCD, if you'll recall, is the limit as epsilon goes to 0. A number of boxes of side length epsilon divided by ln of 1 over epsilon. Cool? So I'm going to just stuff in the things that I have for these, you know, my exponential things. So, okay, this is the limit as epsilon goes to 0 of, I can take a negative out of this, right? This is minus ln of epsilon. Because 1 over epsilon is epsilon to the minus 1, and the log rule says I can pull that down in front. Okay, I'm going to stuff in the things that I know. So this negative is going to hang out front, and I'll have ln. N is going to be the number of boxes of size d that I start with, which in the picture is just 1, times e to the k h1 minus h2. And in the denominator, I have ln of my box side length d e to the k h2. So I've snuck the negative up to the top. It was in the denominator here, but you can put it in either spot. I said this, but I'll write it down, where n of d is the number of boxes of side length d that we start with. So it's sort of the, in the picture we started with just one of those, but it's has the effect of being a constant area term that we've seen in the past kind of is going to fall away. Like, here's a product inside the log. I'll split them up. N of d is a constant. It's however many boxes I started with. And in the limit, that'll just disappear with respect to how big the other things are. Questions about what we're looking at here? Somehow this is going to turn into this thing down here if we don't mess up. So let's try. Oh, nicely. Natural logs and exponentials. I see them all of a sudden. So that's good. When the natural log and the exponential hit each other, I should simplify. I should get just whatever's in the exponent. All right. I guess I have a... This doesn't really make sense to have the epsilon in here anymore because there's no epsilon. So let's scratch this and say k is going to infinity. Same idea. Epsilon was my side length. And if k goes to infinity, that has the effect of, you know, these exponential side length terms here. H2 is a number that we're going to try and figure out eventually. D is a constant, e to the k. So as my number of iterates goes to infinity, this thing is, h of 2 is negative. This is getting smaller. So I'm switching my limits to k going to infinity because I don't have any epsilons in my expression anymore. Yeah?
You said The number of boxes of side length D. Are you looking at which part of the, I'm trying to associate that with the picture.
Yeah.
Because you're not using boxes of side length D in the right hand bit.
Right, because they're shrinking. Remember, as my box size gets smaller, my number gets bigger. No, I'd be measuring them with boxes of side length d e to the kh too.
Yeah.
For whatever k is.
Where are we counting the number of
n, capital N of side length d to start with? Here. So let's say instead of this, I had done this. Then I'd have four boxes of side length d to start with, and this term right here would be four instead of one. Yeah? And then, you know, what would end up happening then is just this would be a little smaller. But in the limit, it's this exponential that'll matter, not the area of the thing that I start with. Yeah. Area is going to slide away, and we're going to talk about dimension. Yeah. Other questions about what's on the board? All right. So let's see if we can not mess this up so bad. So limit of k goes to infinity. I'm going to split those up. So I have minus ln of n of d, and I have minus ln of e to the k h1 minus h2. Cool. I split them up. And then I'm going to do same thing in the denominator, but what do I have here? I have ln of d plus ln of e to the k h2. Can I simplify any of these things that I have here? Yeah? All right. Limit k goes to infinity, numerator minus ln of n, I'm going to drop the d, but it's in there, minus, and then I got ln of e. So this just gives me kh1 minus h2, and I'm going to make that a plus k h2 minus h1. Cool? That work out okay? We will crash and burn if I get any of this wrong, so please let me know. And then, all right, denominator, I still have an ln of d. And then I got these two canceling, so I have a k plus kh2. K going to infinity, that's an important thing because that means that this n, which we were saying was 1 to start with or 4, this is a number. D is also just a number that doesn't change. That's however big my box was to begin with. So these two things, as k goes to infinity, these are constants, and they're tiny compared with what's happening over here. That's going to infinity. That's going to infinity. So this stuff on the left, I'm going to just erase that. It's inconsequential with respect to what's going on in the fraction. All right, so this is... cool. So this is roughly equal to, for our purposes, limit k goes to infinity. What do I have? I have k h2 minus h1 divided by k h2. Cool. So the k's are going to cancel, which means my limit disappears, and I get h2 minus h1 divided by h2, which is 1 minus h1 over h2, which on the face of it looks not good because I wanted 1 plus some stuff. Somebody save me. H2 is negative, h1 is positive. So this negative and that negative are going to cancel, and I'm going to get 1 plus some stuff. Yeah? In fact, if I do this, I could say this is equal to 1 plus h1 divided by the absolute value of H2. Which, for the example of m being 2 and our h is straddling 0 with their sum being negative, the shrinking's more powerful than the stretching. For that example, this is exactly this formula. I have an integer 1 plus some fractional component coming from the other stuff. And if the stretching is particularly strong, like if this is close to 1, I get more, my dimension's almost 2. If my shrinking is really, really powerful compared with the stretching, then I'll end up with something just a little bit bigger than 1. That should all feel okay with respect to how this should balance out. Okay, we've done this in two dimensions here, and similarly, if we decided to do it in 3, and I had cubes, you know, the set in there might turn into some sort of lasagna-looking thing or spaghetti-looking thing if there were two really strong contracting directions instead of, if there's one contracting direction, you get the lasagna. Anyway, you'd end up in that case with p being 2, and you'd get the sum of the first two h's being a small positive number, the third h being negative, and when added to the first two h's, making things negative. And then you'd get 2, if this is the lasagna situation, 2 plus some stuff, because the lasagna is folding around all on top of it. You get the dust in that third direction.
Why can we sort of ignore the ln of n of d over ln of d?
Right. So if this were a term on its own, like if the rules of fractions said I could peel this piece off and add this piece to it, then we couldn't, because that's a number. It's a constant, yeah? But because k is going to infinity, and that's happening in both the numerator and the denominator, this term's getting huge, this term's getting huge. These two are tiny relative to those two. And so the ln of d being added to something that's infinite, it doesn't matter at all. And this subtraction from something that's infinite also doesn't matter at all. You're right, though, that if I were looking at this fraction plus this fraction, I could not ignore those things. Yeah. Other questions? Okay. Nice. So we're, the box counting dimension, we can kind of understand what's going on. The Lyapunov exponent, we're going to get a number between 1 and 2 or between 2 and 3, and it's harder to understand, but you'd get the same answer doing the boxes. So that's nice. Because this is the sort of thing that the computer can spit back really easily, these three H's, or the two H's, or however many there are. Easily in quotes. You're going to learn how to do that in the next 48 hours, but okay. Moving on. You'll remember we had this concept of the Brouwer's fixed point theorem, where if I took the crumpled piece of paper and I uncrumple it, there's some point that didn't move, or vice versa. We're going to try and understand that, because it has consequences to our... What we're going to do now is we have higher dimensional sets, and we're going to be thinking about what periodic points look like. And if I take a ball around a point, and that ball gets sent to an ellipse over here, or better yet, if the ball, this ball here gets mapped across itself, what that means about the existence of fixed points. So it turns out, in fact, that if I take, so let me do this a little more carefully. If I take an initial value and I put a ball around it, and then I map that ball and it lands, does something like this,
it turns out there's a fixed point in there, even if, you know, this point right here may have been mapped over there. Here's V0, here's V1. There's a fixed point in there. Consequent of this, you know, this idea of the Brouwer's fixed point theorem. And it's a consequence of that. So we're gonna try to understand why. It's gonna be important for us. We'll be thinking about using, remember how things got a lot sort of simpler in some ways when we were able to use itineraries, lists of L's and R's, instead of actually iterating the map and getting orbit points. We're gonna wanna do that in higher dimensions too. We're gonna want it to be the case that if we take some region and we stretch it across itself like this, we wanna do this symbolically with letters instead of my silly pictures. So, all right, so that's what we're gonna do. We have the fixed point theorem and the Brouwer's fixed point theorem. We're gonna write down a related thing. So this is about 5.4 in your book, which is about fixed point theorem in 2D. Cool. So here's our motivating theorem. We're gonna let F be a continuous map. On R2. And we're going to let S be a rectangular region such that as the boundary of S is traversed, the net rotation of the vectors V of X equals F of X minus X is non-zero. I'll have to draw a picture to get that. Then F has a fixed point in S. So we're going to take a rectangle, we're going to map it, and we're going to draw vectors from the boundary of my rectangle to, you know, wherever they start to where they go onto the map. Those are these vectors V. All right, so I have my rectangle that I'm starting with. This is S. And I'm sending S through this map, and that's when I get the wavy stick of gum. And it lies across my original region S that I started with. We'll name the center of the original set S C hat. We'll start sketching a proof of this theorem. Let the center of S be C hat. Okay. And then we're going to, C hat's not fixed, by the way. F of C hat is not C hat. It's going somewhere else under the map. We're going to put points down on the boundary of S and draw vectors to where they go. And they're going to go kind of where you think they go. We're not going to do anything weird here. So like this point here gets sent, you know, up to this corner, and this corner here gets sent up to that corner. Under the map F. So this blue thing we should write, this is F of S, the blue shape. Uh, Okay, we'll put down a few more points just so we have our bearings. So each of these vectors is a v. So this is v of x. If this is x right here, x. This point down here is v of x, where it gets sent. Actually, that point is. Let me do this better than I'm doing it. F of s is this set. This is f of x right here. And the vector between f and x, f of x minus x, this is v. Cool. And what we're going to do is pay attention to the rotation of these vectors. And it will be helpful if I draw another example where this doesn't happen. So let me do a different set. S over here. That gets mapped like this. Here's another set, S and where it gets sent, F of S. We're going to look at the vectors V as we traverse. So we're going to go, this is a weird thing we do lots of time in math classes. We try and walk around a boundary and count how many times our arrow changes direction. Ooh, there's long arrows over there. I'll use those. All right, so let's start in the top left corner and walk around and see what happens. So my vector's pointing from this point up to that point, like that, okay? I'm going to walk around. Count how many times the chalk eraser or spins around. So I went around the set counterclockwise, and the chalk eraser, whiteboard eraser, who knows what it is, spun around once counterclockwise. Clockwise, the opposite of what I said the first time. So let's do it again. I'm going to go around counterclockwise. This thing's going to turn around once clockwise. Pay attention. Cool? So this thing went around once. That's not going to happen over here. Let's do it over here. Ready? Same story. Not as interesting. All right, so which thing's going to have a fixed point? What do you think? The one on the left has a fixed point. All right. In our, you know, we're going to try and see why that's true. Why we get a fixed point on the left and not on the right. It's the same idea as our Brouwer's fixed point theorem here. Okay. We're letting S be the C hat be the center of S. If F of C hat is C hat, we're done. And that was easy. If not, start shrinking S. So I'm going to take my rectangle, and I'm going to start. And by shrinking it, I mean like, OK, so we're going to zoom in on C hat. Yeah? I'm taking this thing, and I'm reducing it in size. I'm zooming in on C hat.
This is weird, but eventually, if I've done that for a while, I get really, really close to C hat. This is the picture. Right, if I zoom in enough on C hat, then everything near me should be doing the exact same thing. Because this function's continuous and we live in this nice world where when you zoom in on a region of R2, F is not doing like super crazy things everywhere near there differently as you move all around. If you zoom in on one region, like everything, all the vectors start to point in the same direction. Okay? All of applied math is built on what I just said. All right, so C hat, this vector, F of C hat minus C hat, this is V, and all of them are gonna get really close to that. And the more I zoom in, the more the rest of these vectors all start to look like that one. All right, so we're in the situation where F of C hat is not C hat, and we're shrinking S, and we get this picture. From this picture, we started with this picture, where the eraser made a full turn. As I went around counterclockwise on the boundary, the eraser made a full turn clockwise. And then I end up with this picture where the eraser does not make a full turn. In fact, it doesn't turn very much at all. So in your head, I want you to think about getting from this picture and what has to happen while we do that. The red square, this is shrinking and shrinking. I'm drawing them the same size because it would be silly for me to put a little tiny red square here. But the red square is shrinking and shrinking, and I eventually get this picture. What has to happen somewhere between this picture and that one? What has to happen? A fixed point. What would a fixed point look like in the picture? What would it look like? What is V? What is V again? V are these black vectors that I'm drawing from the boundary of S to the boundary of the shape F of S.
So yeah. V kind of explains the change, the difference in
yes.
the points,
yes.
and then one of those vectors is going to go to zero.
Yeah, it is. So eventually, V of X, so this is a vector, this is equal to zero. Why is it equal to zero? Well, I have to at some point, like, so I got a bunch of, so this vector over here is pointing in the right direction, but this one here is not. This one's pointing back in the wrong way. And eventually, as I shrink this red rectangle, the blue wavy thing is going to sort of like work its way over, okay? And eventually, it's got to be over off to the right. So at some point, there will be a point on this boundary where this boundary and this boundary, it sort of would reduce to a one-dimensional situation, would overlap and the V would be zero. And that's like a little cowlick in this vector field. It has to make a full turn or no, it has to make an integer number of turns, my eraser. It can't turn, 1.3 times around as I go all the way around the circle. So, or 0.3 times. So it needs to at some point, and when that zero happens and I slide through that zero where the two boundary points represent that fixed point, as soon as I've slid through that, okay, then all the vectors, they might, it might rotate all the way around and it kind of, I'll get close and then come back the same direction and unwind itself and come back to the same direction it was going in. So let me show you what that would look like. So eventually when I get to that point, it's trying to make a clockwise turn and it makes it over here, but then because of what's happened, I end up with this, after I've gone through the fixed point, they're all going back. It is going to unwind itself like so. And I'll end up with zero complete turns. It almost made a complete turn, but then it didn't. Yeah.
It has to be an integer rotation because on the right one when you did it, wasn't it a fraction?
Good. On the right one, I'm counting how many times does it spin around? And the answer is here, it's sort of like it starts to turn, and then it starts to turn back, and it sort of undoes itself. So zero is the integer number of times that it does as I go around on the picture on the right. Yeah?
So
So the fact that there's going to be some vector that eventually sort of becomes zero, is that because of some sort of like mean value theorem? Because like if you're looking at the left picture, if all of the vectors on that right side were, for example, pointing downwards, then I could imagine like none of the vectors sort of becoming zero in the vertical direction.
Good, very good. So it is very important that this blue shape overlaps the red one vertically. It could overlap it horizontally. But if that wasn't the case, like if some of this set was inside the red shape, then it would not lie across the red shape, and that we would, you know, the fixed point theorem that we know and love wouldn't apply to the situation. And that's effectively what you're describing. Yeah. Yeah, so as we're sliding this through, and the number of complete, the intermediate, you were asking about the intermediate value theorem, it's not exactly that, but as we're sliding this through, we end up with an integer number, you know, we have to do one complete turn, you know, the eraser has to do one complete turn or zero complete turns, and there's no midpoint between those two. So when it will happen at this cowlick point, effectively, where the vector shrinks and shrinks and shrinks, and I can't tell you where it is, I'm making this up, but it would, you know, it eventually would shrink to length zero, and that would be the place that the eraser turns back around instead of making a complete turn. And then eventually the picture looks like this. So, all right, so at this point, wherever this happens, we should give it a different name than x, because that's all over the place. X star, we'll call it X star. All right, so at X star, I have a fixed point. And let's, you know, just for the sake of argument, let's put that right here. All right, it's not on the boundary of the blue set now, or the red set now, but as I shrink the red set, eventually it is on the boundary. And so the blue and the red overlap at that spot, and that spot is the fixed point. Okay. I said some things, but we didn't write them down. So we're shrinking x, s, eventually v of x equals 0. This is because the vectors must change continuously and must make an integer number of turns as we traverse the boundary. All right, and so eventually, this is true. Also, eventually, the picture looks like this. As S shrinks, let's say it's shrunk a lot, the picture looks like this. Because if I think about continuous vector fields, you know, they can have all kinds of fun shapes to them, but if you zoom in and zoom in and zoom in on a region, then the rates of change, the sort of the higher order terms in a Taylor series expansion, they're all tiny, because that h is the width of this region that we're zooming in on. So then, you know, things have to look pretty much linear, everything going in the same direction once these are small. Okay. And then this point, we're writing all over the place. The point x star will appear on the boundary and then as you shrink x or s a little bit more past that point, then the vectors v don't make a full integer rotation. They almost do, but then they come back. So we wouldn't have to use these shapes. We could use a disk. I was saying a disk turning into an ellipse is an example just like this. Yeah, the theorem here is independent of what You know, it says rectangular region, but it could be any shape that you do this with. Cool, and so we'll often end up with a situation where we have, you know, some set A that we're starting with, and we map it, and we get some new set B, where B is F of A. And then we map B, and we get some new set C, where C is F of B, and it's F2 of A. And the properties of this sequence, we're going to be paying attention to them. You know, this C is going to start to, maybe it's warping, and it's shrinking, it's stretching. Well, there's a fixed point in there. And it could be that there are period 2 points in here and period 3 points in here, and we'll be able to figure that out based on the orientation of these things relative to each other. So this is a really important idea. We talked about it a little bit in the past, but in I think you're going to do a homework on this too coming up. The idea of shadowing is coming. All semester we've been talking about numerically calculating orbits of chaotic dynamical systems, which are sensitively dependent on their initial condition. So I give you an initial value, you iterate it on the computer, and then you get this picture. Well, the picture you get isn't the actual orbit of that point, because you approximated the point when you put it in the computer. The computer approximated where it was sent after one iterative of the map, and then again approximated where that point is sent at the end. So every time you take an orbit of a point, every time through one of those loops, you're leaving the actual orbit and going to some other one. And the true orbit of that second point on your thing, you don't ever see that. You just see where x2 goes to x3. That's on some other orbit. And because they're every time you send it through the computer, you land on a new orbit. So, these are sensitively dependent equations you're iterating. So it's kind of a disaster then thinking about, well, what is this actually, does the picture that I see have anything to do with the actual, shape that point's supposed to go to? Well, okay, if it's going to a sink, yes, that all the points will go to the same place. If it's producing some chaotic attractor, maybe, because that attractor, all points, all initial values in the basin of that attractor make a shape like that. The one you're seeing is this hodgepodge of lots of them, but it looks quite a bit like the actual one. So there's a whole branch of math trying to figure out when this works, like when the picture that you get back from the computer actually represents reality, or what would happen if you did it analytically by hand. And turns out that it all works nicely and everything's going to be fine, provided that this sort of stretching and shrinking that you see preserves its orientation relative to, you can see here, like A, B laid across A vertically, C laid across B vertically. Very nice. Okay, and they can turn a little bit, whatever, that's fine. They can warp. But when you have situations where like A goes to this, to B, and then as you go to some other region of the state space, the orientations change relative to each other, and you have one direction where things were spreading apart and all of a sudden they're shrinking in that direction, and one direction in which things were shrinking and now they're starting to spread apart, that is a much harder situation to be able to predict the future state of, because we don't get these nice properties. Turns out that you can, even for a chaotic orbit, you can always, like if this point, over here is chaotic, I can always find something nearby close enough that stays close to that thing for as long as I want. Even though they're spreading apart from each other exponentially, I could just pick them close enough to each other that they, to begin with, that they stay together for as long as I'd like. That's not true if it turns out if this orientation isn't preserved. Shadowing, this is shadowing, it fails when these things, these Lyapunov exponent dimensions in number change. Some shrinking direction becomes positive. I go into the taffy pulling machine and I say, nope, we're going to go in this direction with everything, and I make a big ribbon, then the whole thing fails. But questions?
The reason we make this, I feel like this theorem is pretty complicated. Overly so?
Yeah, you mean like with the V's and everything?
With the vectors and the rotation mm-hmm. and everything. Mm-hmm. Like basically, it's pretty obvious that if you cover the set and it's stretching one way, there's going to be a fixed point somewhere there. Is the reason we do that, I mean, you could probably make another theorem that says the same thing. Is the reason we do that because to make more general regions that aren't rectangular, or what's the reason that we use the vector rotation?
Right. Well, I'm thrilled.
The question is why are we using these vectors? It feels a little complicated. I'm thrilled that your intuition at this point makes it feel like, oh yeah, there should be a fixed point in there. That's good. I don't know on the first day of class whether you would have that, you know, like, oh, with the crumpled paper, like it totally makes sense that a point, as I uncrumple the paper and spread it back out across itself, I don't know where, but there's some point that didn't move.
Right.
That certainly didn't feel like an obvious thing to me when I first started thinking about it, but yeah, it works. And so the question, you know, why do we use these vectors? Well, it makes identifying the point where that happens as we shrink S kind of obvious, right? As we take this boundary and start shrinking it, you know, it lands on the boundary of S, and it's, you know, the F of S, you know, is F of that point, X star, is the same spot, X star, the vectors of length 0.
You can find it.
Yeah. Other questions?